Okay, I'm getting yes. Okay. So today we are going to see the topic HTTPS, VPN, and the what are the website security consideration. Okay. So first of all, we study HTTPS. Okay. First topic that we are going to study, which is HTTPS. So before HTTPS, we will be studying HTTP and HTTPS, and what is the difference? What is the difference between these two? Okay, and why there is a term S inside over here? Okay, so normally if you want to access any website, okay, normally if you want to access any website, so here you can see this is my gmail.com. You can see here. Okay, you'll be seeing here https://mail.com. Okay, so you will be getting a link, right? You will be writing the link which is starting from https or http. Okay, so or when you type here for facebook.com or gmail.com, it will automatically redirect the link that will be taken as a http or https, depends upon the service that has been provided, okay, by the web page. Okay, normally if you are how we are going to access this, normally this HTTP protocol is a client server protocol. Okay, it is a client server protocol. So we have a client over here. This is a client machine. Maybe this is a user, okay, someone which has a Google Chrome. So he might be using Google Chrome as a web browser, and this will be connected to the server. Okay, so this is the server. So this is the server of that particular web page. Okay, so whenever you want to access the Google Chrome, google.com, so it will give the connection, it will get the connection from the, first of all, it will establish the connection between the web browser and the web server. Okay, after that, if the connection is success, it will be sending you the web page. Okay, so this is the process, normal process of accessing the information from a particular web page. Okay, so now what is the use of HTTP? Okay, what is the use of HTTP? Why we are using HTTP specifically and HTTPS specifically for accessing the web page? Because these protocol, that is the HTTP and HTTPS protocol. Okay, what is the use of this protocol? With the help of this protocol, the information of the particular website exchanged between the web browser and the web server. Okay, with this protocol only we can able to access a particular web page, or the particular web page information will be sent between the Chrome and the server. Okay, between the server. Okay, so we can say the information of the web browser sorry not the web browser the web page sorry the information of the web page is exchanged between web browser and the server, okay, using this protocol. So why we are using HTTP protocol? If you want to get any information of a particular website, we will be using the HTTP protocol. Okay, now this HTTP, what is the difference between HTTP and HTTPS? HTTP is not secure, but HTTP is secure protocol. How it became a secure protocol? Okay, first of all, we see the components of this HTTP. Okay, components of HTTP and HTTPS. So there is nothing different. The first one is the client. So who is the client? Anyone who access any web page. Okay, for example, a user, and you are not the or we, okay, we people are not the client. The browser on behalf of us is accessing the information. So the browser which we are using, the IP, that is a client. Okay, so the client sending the request to the server in order to get the response of the particular web page. Okay, then the second component that we have is server. Okay, server. So here request has been made by user agent or a client. Here we have the server where response for the particular response of a particular website is provided. Here we have the client and server. So in between that, we have another one important term of component called proxy. Okay, so what do you mean by proxy? The proxy which may include the gateway, router, then we have switches, we have firewalls, okay, and we have load balancer. Okay, so all these five important component that is included in the proxy, okay, are included in proxy. Okay, so what are the important term important components of the HTTP or HTTPS? We have the client which is requesting the particular web page, and the server which in order to give the response, it accepts the request and it is providing you the response. Where the third component that we have is a proxy. Here the proxy which may include gateway, router, switches, firewalls, load balancer, everything that is included in the proxy. So we'll see what is happening over here in HTTP and HTTPS. Okay, so here there is a client and here there is a proxy. Before the proxy, I'll just draw the internet. There is a internet. Okay, and here there is a server. So this is a client, and here it may be the proxy. Okay, so anything if we want to access, okay, it will go through the proxy only. And here there will be lots of routers. Okay, all the routers which is been connected in the internet, that has been provided by the different ISPs which are connected. So these are the ISP providers. Okay, ISP, various various ISP providers provided the internet services. Okay. So now, so this is my client. Okay, if it wants to access any web page of the, for example, if I want to access the web page of google.com. Okay. Nowadays, when we click on Google Chrome, it is okay. It is actually this showing. So I'll write here gmail.com, or we'll take facebook.com. Okay, facebook.com. So what is happening over here when the client requests the web page? So the proxy. So here the proxy. What are the components which is present in the proxy? We have a gateway. We have a gateway. Okay. We have a router. We have a switches. Okay. Switches, and we have a firewall. Okay. This is a firewall. We have a switch. This is a router. And we have a gateway. Okay. So when we give a request, a get request from the when we give a get request from the web browser, so it will go through the firewall, switches, routers, and gateway to the internet. Okay, to the internet, where there are lots of protocols that has been followed. Okay, in order to send, and how the data has been flowing into the network. As this is a HTTP request and we are connecting to the we are transferring through the internet, it is an IP packet. Okay, so the IP packets will be sent through the internet to the server. Okay, to the server. Now this server, when it accepts the request, it gives the response back to the client. So this is the normal working of the HTTP. Now, where is the security? Now, where is the security lying in the HTTP? And one more thing you want to remember about HTTP is, HTTP sends the information as a plain text. Sends the information as plain text. Okay. So, what do you mean by plain text? If I am sending google.com, it is sending the request as google.com only. Okay, so what happens, somebody can enter into the network. Okay, if I am sending the HTTP request of google.com, it will send the request http://gmail.com. So if I write like this, the information will be sent through the internet like this only. Okay, if some intruder entered into my network and he can change, instead of gmail.com, he can change to any unauthorized website, and he can provide the server like http://gmail.com. Okay, something. Okay, he can change the web page, and according to this change, we will not get the gmail.com page, we will be receiving the foo.com page. And you might be experienced like when there is a Diwali function, or there is a Christmas function, or anything, there will be a website like click this, you will be getting the phone, you will be getting the Apple iPhone, or you will be getting the some good phones or tablets like that. So they will be giving you a request like this. So once you click on this, it will be accessing like there will be some a game. When you play that game, so you will be it will be telling you that you won the match, and it will be telling you have to share this to your friends, like that. There is a message. And once if you don't want that, and if you go back, so what will happen, it will be redirected to another web page. Okay, how it is happening? Because the website is not secure. Because somebody is already coded that when you click back, you have to go to that some unauthorized web page it will go. So so these are all the examples for the HTTP. So HTTP sends the information as a plain text. It is not secure. It is not at all secure. Somebody can enter into the network and he can change the request that we made, and in response, whatever the change that attacker does, so we will be receiving that only. Okay, so HTTP is not secure at all. HTTP is not secure at all. So now we studied HTTP, right? So now we wanted to know about what is HTTPS doing. Okay, and before that, I wanted to give you one simple information about HTTP and HTTPS. Okay, HTTP and HTTPS is HTTP. Some important point. I'll write it in another color so that okay. So HTTP and HTTPS is a stateless protocol. Stateless protocol. So anybody know what is stateless protocol? What is this stateless means? Anybody? Students? Anybody? Do you know what is stateless protocol means? Stateless. What do you mean by stateless? Anybody? Put it in the chat box. No one? You have not studied in CN, computer network? Tell me yes or no. Client doesn't save data received. Client doesn't save data received. No. No, it was a little bit different. Okay, so let me at least Anurag Yadav messaged me. Very good, Anurag. Okay, so what do you mean by stateless protocol? So stateless means state independent. Okay, what do you mean by stateless? It is state independent. So stateless means state independent. What do you mean by state independent? It is nothing but it does not hold the session. That means sometime when we use gmail.com, somebody is telling you like your voice is not audible. Okay, so what you will do, you will just refresh the page and again you will enter. So once you refresh the page, what is happening? It is creating a new page. It is last session is automatically timed out. It is stopped and it is closed. Okay. And it again creates a new session. Okay. Again creates a new session and the web page is opening properly now. Okay. So always what we'll do? Every time if the website is not working, we will refresh. Why we are refreshing it? Because the previous session has been closed and the new session has been created. Okay. So here also we are doing in the HTTP and HTTP protocols are stateless protocol. So it does not hold the session. So if you click the refresh button, that means it opens the page, a new fresh page. So sometimes you might be experienced like when you filling a form, okay? So when you click the refresh page, what will happen? All the contents that you have entered in the web page might be lost. You need to enter it again. Why it is happening? Because the previous session's connections were timed out. It is timed out. Okay, it was not open. Okay, so whenever you refresh the page, so the web page is opening newly. A new session has been created. Okay, that is why the HTTP protocol is called as stateless protocol. It does not hold the web page. Okay, if session is closed, if we cancel or if we close the session, then it will be closed. Again, you need to open it newly. Okay, and so this is a very, very important information I wanted to give you, what is stateless. Okay, now this HTTP, what is the port number of this HTTP? The port number, you might be knowing the port number of HTTP is port 80. Port number is what? Port 80. And the port number of HTTPS is what? 443. Okay, there is a difference between both. Okay, and when you use HTTP and HTTPS, HTTP will work very faster. It is very fast. Okay, very fast. But in HTTPS, it is little bit slower. Okay, it is slower than HTTP. Okay, it is slower than the HTTP. Why it is slower than HTTP? Because we use some sort of security that we are providing to the HTTPS protocol. Okay, so what is that? What security that we are providing? And one more difference. I wanted to mention that in HTTP, this HTTP is working under the application layer. Okay, it works on application layer. But HTTPS works on transport layer. Okay, transport layer. Okay, yesterday we studied two questions, right? SSL and TLS. What does the SSL and TLS is doing? It is providing you security. Okay, it is providing you security to transfer your data. So here the HTTPS uses the SSL or the TLS security to transfer the messages. Now we'll see how this HTTPS works. Okay, how this HTTPS is working. So whenever we type HTTPS and something, you can see here. And one more information I have is, you can see here, this is a, you can see here, your connection to this site is not secure. You can see here what is the web browser has been written, http://info.sen.ch. So this is some HTTP site. So when I click on this, here you can see not secure. Okay, and there is a warning mark. So when you click here, you can see here your connection to this site is not secure. You should not enter any sensitive information on this site. Okay, they are just giving you a warning. Okay. Okay, so this is something for HTTP. But when you see HTTPS, okay, so here you can see there is a lock. Okay, so this lock means it is providing you that the connection is secure. Even if the connection, the lock is open, then also the connection is not secure. Anybody can enter into the network. Okay. So here you can see connection is secure, and you can see the certificates that we have already studied in the digital certificate. You can see the details of this. Okay. So what I'm telling here is the HTTPS provided with some security. Okay. So who is providing that security? The SSL, HTTP plus SSL or TLS. Security that has been provided. What do you mean by SSL? That is the secure socket layer. Or TLS. What is TLS? The transport layer security that has been provided to the particular HTTP web page or HTTP request in order to transfer. Okay. How it works now? Suppose this is a client. Okay. Suppose this is a client. Client which is sending the request through the proxy. Okay, through the proxy. We have some important information on the proxy also. So we'll see when we send a request. Suppose if I am sending you www.gmail.com, okay, gmail.com. So what this HTTPS is doing is it encrypts first. Okay, it encrypts. So it may be encrypting using some kind of hashing methods, or it may be using some kind of block cipher methods. Okay, any kind of encryption algorithm it might be using RSA or SHA-256, any kind of encryption algorithm it will be using, and it is creating a encrypted message. Okay, now this encrypted message, once it reaches the server, okay, once it reaches the server, now this server checks the, again, how we studied the TLS protocol, we verified the version, we verified the algorithms that has been encrypted. So it verifies the version, the algorithm, encryption algorithm. Okay, so it will be provided with the version, encrypted algorithm. Okay, so here also it will be verified with that version and the algorithm. So once it verified, then what will happen? This server will provide a certificate. Okay, digital certificate. So now this digital certificate is owned by the Google CA authority. Okay, so now this authority will be checked by the client, and upon receiving this, it will be sending the session key. It will be sending the session key has been initiated, and after that, once the server receives the session key, it will send the data. What is the data here? It is a web page. It is the web page. Okay. Now, in the middle, what this proxy is doing? What is the use of proxy here? Okay. What is the use of proxy here? The proxy which functions in different forms. Okay. The function. What is the process of functions of proxy? So when we transfer the data and once we receive the response, what the proxy is doing actually? Okay, function of this proxy. What is the function of proxy? The first function it is caching. Okay, so what do you mean by caching? So whenever you transfer any data, or whenever you access any kind of web page, it will be storing when you accessed that page, how many times you accessed that page, and for example, like the history and the browser details, whatever it is. So like a cookie, so it will store all the information in the proxy. Okay, so first function is caching. Okay, it is like a history or a browser that we have used, browser of the cache. Okay, it caches all the information that we are accessing through the web browser. Second function that it uses is filtering. Okay, filtering. So filtering in the sense, for example, if there is any unauthorized access is happening over in the internet, so what will happen? It will automatically filter that. Okay, it acts like a antivirus scan. Okay, antivirus scan. So it filters what are the necessary things. If it is a necessary web page or it is not, then if it is not like you can see here. So here I opened this. So what it is showing me, your connection to this site is not secure. But sometimes when we access any website, it will be telling you this is not an authorized web page. Okay, you will get an information like that. So that work, who is doing that work? That work is done by the proxy. Okay, proxy. Then third function here is the load balancing. Okay, load balancing. What is this load balancing? Okay, so this load balancing is nothing but that there can be number of number of web pages. Okay, anyone can access anytime at the through the server, right? Suppose this is a Google server. Okay, Google server. Okay, at a particular time many can access the server. Okay, so whenever we transmit a signal to the transmit any information to the Google server, what is happening, it should regulate that from it should segregate server, in the sense the in the Google server there is no one server, there may be 50 or 100 number of servers. So what if the information that we are, the request that we are making from the client side will be fragmented to the particular any of those 10 servers, and it should get the web page. Okay, so that is called load balancing. If there is no load balancing, what will happen? Only one server gets the request of all the users, all the clients. Suppose in a particular time, if 10,000 requests are making, if 10,000 clients are sending the request, what will happen? The load will not be balanced, right? So it will be like rotating. It will not give you the web page. So load balancing is also important, that segregate that where to go and which server it needs to reach, and all is routed by this load balancing. Then the fourth function that we have is authentication. Okay, this authentication is nothing but where the digital certificate that has been verified by the client and the server. Okay, so that is what authentication, where when the server is providing you digital certificate, it needs to verify that it is provided by the Google CA, Google Certified Authority. Okay, if it is not proper one, then what will happen? PROSI will filter it out. Okay, then the fifth important thing that we have is logging. Okay, logging. So logging details, where how many what is the user, okay, how many users they logged into this website, and how many times they accessed this website, and what web pages that has been accessed. Suppose if I'm using google.com and if I'm typing here about the HTTP, so what will happen? It will give me the information, and the information what I asked for in the google.com is HTTP. So in the logging information, it will be sent into the table where it is entered that this time at this particular day at this particular timestamp, okay, the information about the HTTP has been requested from this website, from this web browser at this IP. Okay, so all the information has been stored in the proxy. Okay, so that is the use of proxy. So proxy verifies everything. After that, it allows, if the verification is successful, then it allows to allows the web browser to communicate, to initiate the session key and to provide the session key to the server. Okay, so this is how the HTTP and HTTPS works. So HTTPS, difference between HTTP and HTTPS is it is providing you the security. It is providing you the security. And one more thing, that HTTP is working under application layer, where HTTPS works under the transport layer protocol. Okay, transport layer is working on the transport layer. Okay, nowadays as I told you that HTTP and HTTP is a stateless protocol. Nowadays for example, e-shopping or like a banking, so if you want to make a payment using GPay or some your card, okay, your debit cards, what you people are doing, you are just going to the web page of for example, if you want to pay Amazon or Zomato, so what do people do? You just clicking that web page, and when it redirects to the payment page, okay, you will be entering the details. At that time, if the browser is not working properly, so what do people do? You will just refresh. Okay, you will go and refresh. At that time, there will be a warning like don't refresh, otherwise the session will be timed out. So if most of the banking server, for example, SBI.com or HDFC.com. So these banks, most of the banks, okay, not these two, most of the banks, they will be providing a warning message that don't refresh or don't go back while making payment. Why? Because the web page is a stateless protocol. It is following a stateless protocol. Once you refresh, it will be creating a new page. So what will happen? The payment, whatever you've done, you will be losing your money. Again, you need to do if you didn't get the confirmation. Okay. So what you need to do, in order to convert this, you need to convert, to avoid this problem, you need to convert this stateless into stateful. Okay. So what will happen nowadays, this HTTP and HTTPS allows the stateless protocol to initiate the session, stateful session. Okay. So nowadays, for example, if somebody requests, then only, okay, for e-shopping, banking, whatever the payment gateway, okay, is happening, no, for that particular websites, nowadays they are providing, nowadays HTTP as well as HTTPS. HTTP and HTTPS allows stateful session, so that even you refresh the page, it will be on the same particular page, okay, payment page, okay, stateful session. So this is provided now, okay. So this is what about the HTTPS, so HTTP and HTTPS, how we can transfer the information through the, how we are going to get access the information. Understood, students, this question, HTTP and HTTPS? Tell me yes or no. Okay, so now next topic that we are going to study is VPN. Okay, VPN. Have you used the VPN any time? Anyone? Have you used VPN? I know most of you have used VPN to play PUBG. Yes or no? Tell me frankly. Yes or no? Do you know about VPN? Anybody? Anybody?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Virtual private network.
Yeah, very good. It is a virtual private network. Do you know how it is working? Yeah, used to watching movies. Very good. So Shiva Mishra openly said that you watched movies. So most probably if you want to download any movie, new movie, so what you'll do? You just go and connect to the VPN and you download the movie. Right? Otherwise, if you want to play, even my brother, he uses VPN to play PUBG games. Okay? Why? What is that VPN? Okay? We are going to study that. Why we are going to study? Why there is a VPN network? Okay? Virtual private network. Virtual private network. Okay, so what is happening in the virtual private network? So we'll study. Suppose there is an office, okay. So office has many computers, okay. So this is an office, okay. And here we have so the consider this is a printer, okay. And there is a mobile phone. Okay. Consider this is a mobile phone. Okay. Consider. And and there is a laptop. Okay, so everything is connected in the office. Okay, everything is just I have in the office there are lots of systems, mobile phones also there, laptop is also there, printer is also there, where this office is connected with a router, right, in order to provide internet. Okay, so consider this is the IP address 192.168.0.2 or 10.2 192.168.10.10.11. So consider this is 192.168.10.13. So all these laptops, printers, and mobile phones are connected in the office. Okay, in the Wi-Fi router. So there is a router which is connected. You have a Wi-Fi network. For example, even in your home, you people are now in the home. You need internet, so you may be used Wi-Fi in your home. So how all the even the TVs, laptops, printers, mobile phones, whatever the electronic equipment which can be connected through the internet, you will be connected into it, right? In order to get internet. So this is what in total we can say this is a private network, right? So in total we can say this is a private network. So what is happening here in the private network? Whenever we want any data, suppose if I want to print anything, okay, I'll just use the Wi-Fi because printer is connected in the Wi-Fi. So printer is available in the network, right? So I will be clicking that printer and I'll just print. So you will be getting the printout. Okay, you will be getting the printouts. Okay, so this is happening in private network. But if I want to access this private network, okay, publicly. So I am in the home. Now everything is became a remote, right? Work from home. Okay, so this is the office network. This is a private network. Now, if I want to access this printer in the public network, how can I access this printer? So I can use VPN. I can use VPN server. So I can connect to the VPN server. Now this VPN server connects to the private network. And suppose if I want to print any document from this printer and I ask someone to take it, okay? Consider that. So I can make the, okay. So let's talk this about later, VPN server. Suppose if somebody wants to access remotely to the printer, what will happen? This will be in the network, okay? So consider that I connected this printer into a public network, okay? Public network. So I made this printer available in the public network, okay? And I can, if I access this public network printer, okay, I can get the printout, okay? Anyone can get the printer, but somebody also can hack this public network, no? Somebody can also hack this printer and he can print lots and lots of pages. Okay, so that is possible. So making the private network into public creates so many problems. Okay, creates so many problems. We need to understand why we are going for VPN server. Okay, why already we can make that the private network into a public network, but why especially VPN? Why especially VPN? Because we want to make a security. We want to make a secure data transfer from a remote machine to the private network. Okay, so what we will do, we will make this into a public, but that printer which should not be available to anyone, that should be available only to that particular user who is using that printer. Okay, in the public. Okay, you need to understand that. Okay, now This is a public network. Okay, this is the public network. Public network is nothing but suppose this private network is our college XIE. What are the systems, the printers, whatever it is connected in XIE is a private network. If I am accessing, if I want to access anything from the system where I work in the lab, okay, so I will be in public. Now I am in a public network. So if I want to access anything from the public network to the private network securely, okay, securely, I can use VPN server. I can use VPN server. Okay. So now, what is the use of this VPN server? Okay. So this VPN server extends this local network so that we can access locally in the public network. Okay. So this is the local network of the particular user. Okay. And this is the local network of the particular area, that is the private network. So both are local network in separate areas. Now this VPN server extends this local network, okay, extend this local network so that we can access it publicly. Okay, so that we can access it publicly. Now how we are going to access this? Okay, how we are going to access this? We'll study. What is the use case? First use case that we saw here is we can access the private network publicly by using VPN server. That is my first use case. Okay. My second use case is what? My second use case is we can hide the identity of the client. So we'll see this. Okay, suppose there is a VPN server and there is a client. Okay, this is a client and these are the VPN servers which is connected in different countries. Okay, maybe in VPN server, maybe in America, okay, New Zealand, Canada, or anything, any, there are different countries. We have VPN server which is connected in different countries. Okay, so what happens when we use VPN server and VPN client? Okay, VPN server and we are the VPN client, right? So we are the VPN client. So this VPN server use a VPN server. Through the VPN server, we are going to access the internet. So these are the internet. If I want to access anything, in between that we have VPN servers. Okay, it might be, okay. So suppose this is Australia and this is America. Okay, and America and this is Canada. Okay, so we have the client. This is the client machine, VPN client. Okay, so what happens if somebody wants to access anything through the internet? How we can hide the identity? Okay, how the VPN is hiding the identity of the particular user? So what happens if a client wants to access the internet? Okay, if a client wants to access the internet, normally how we will be accessing the internet? The ISP service provider. Okay, so it will access directly the internet by using different ISP internet service providers, right? So now these internet service providers, what they have the information of this, if I am accessing any information in the google.com, or if I want to watch a movie, okay, I'm typing in the google.com, okay, I want to watch this movie, I want to download this, okay, so what will happen, my request will be sent to that particular, so it will be creating so many options. Once I click that, I will be getting some kind of information. So from that, the ISP stores my IP address, okay. For example, if I am taking the if my IP address is 160.10.9, okay, so it has the IP address, it has the timestamp when I accessed, it has the all the information, okay, all the information about me will be stored in the ISP service provider, okay. Now what is happening here, whenever government is also regulated this ISP, if they want to identify is there any miscommunication is happening, for example in WhatsApp, somebody talked something about Modi ji, okay, so what will happen, he was directly captured by the police, okay, why how it is happening, because whatever we transfer, no, it will be somebody is listening to that, somewhere it is stored, okay, somewhere it is stored, and that is regulated, and every information that is transferred through the ISP only, okay, internet, so sorry, not through the ISP, it is transferred through the internet, okay, and who is regulating that? Internet service providers are regulating that. So now this internet service provider has the information, whatever you transfer, okay, whatever we transfer through the internet, but they will not publicly send, or they there will be some kind of security and privacy that we have, okay, but sometimes if government wants to point out somebody, okay, somebody, for example, recently there is a problem which has happened for the farmers, okay, and some 29 years old people, they tried to converse, they were conversing on the WhatsApp, okay, the information is collected by the government and they were jailed, okay, they were in jail now. So how it is happening, because whatever the information that we are transferring through the internet, that is recorded, okay, every information that is collected by the ISP, okay. So if somebody gives money, okay, more amount of money, if they are giving and they want to access any information about you, they can give, it is possible. So if you want to, what people are doing is they want to hide their identity, okay, so they are using VPN server. Now VPN server, if you want to access any VPN server, you want to install a particular software, they will be providing you username and password, right? So once the username and password has been created, so when you log into the VPN server, you will be the VPN client now, okay. Now whatever you type, okay, suppose you are you want to access a particular movie, so you will be sending the data packets to the VPN server. Now this VPN server hides the identity, okay, hides the identity of the VPN client, and it sends the data packet to the internet where the web page is there, okay, web page is stored. After that you will be receiving that information from the VPN server to the client. The information flows through like this, okay, the web page accessed by the VPN server, and it will be connected to the internet where the web page has been stored, okay, where we stored, and after that it will be sending the information about the web page, and it will be receiving. So here, what this VPN server is located in anywhere in the world, okay, so when you connect to the VPN, this VPN may be in America, so it will be locating the person in America, and it will be accessing the information, so it will hide the identity of the particular user, okay, it hides the identity of the particular user, okay. So now this VPN server has some one important protocol that is called, okay, that it uses, VPN uses important protocol called tunneling protocol. Okay, important protocol called tunneling protocol. Okay, so how it is hiding the information? Okay, so it uses one important protocol called tunneling protocol. Okay, suppose this is the local network. Suppose this is the local network. Local network, and you want to access. For example, we'll take this previous example. Okay, so this is the local network of a printer. Okay, and this is the local network of a user working in remote. Working user works in remote. Okay, remote. So now this is a public network and this is a private network. Okay, so local network in the sense this is a private network, but this is a public network. Okay, so now what is going to happen here is, first of all, it will connect to the VPN server. Here also there will be a VPN server. Okay, so this is the VPN server. This is also a VPN server. Okay. So now this VPN server, between these VPN server, there is a tunnel will be created between these two server. Okay, tunnel will be created between these two server. So this is called tunnel. Okay, and this tunneling has two important property, which has encapsulation and encryption. Okay, two important property that is called as encapsulation and encryption. Okay, suppose if I want to, this is my local network, 192.168.0.12, and here it is 192.168.0.15. okay, these are two local networks, so A and B. Okay, now this is my virtual network, that is C. I'll write here 20.20.1.1.1 and D, which is 10.1.1.1. So this is somewhere else in the internet. Okay, so what is happening here, whenever a client requests for a particular web page, okay, or a particular videos or audios or anything, okay, so whenever a client requests, it will go to the VPN server. So now this VPN server, what it will do, it uses the tunneling protocol. First of all, it creates a tunnel between the VPN server, between the two local network. Okay, so it creates a tunnel. So once it creates a tunnel, it encapsulates the data, because the data are transferred as a packets, IP packets. Now this IP packets will be encapsulated. Okay, normally what will be there in the IP packet? Okay, these are the IP packets. These are the IP packets. What will be there in the IP packets? This IP packets has the header and the payload data. Okay, header and the payload. Now, this header and the header has the information about the client's IP address, client's location, his longitude and latitude. Okay, where he is exactly, all the information that is placed in the header. Okay, now this VPN server encapsulates or wrap, okay, with a new header file. Okay, a new header file that is called encapsulation. So it wraps with the new header file, and then it encrypts all these things. It encrypts all these things using a SHA-256 or SHA-512 or RSA algorithm, any kind of algorithm. It encrypts After that, it sends the encrypted data. Okay, it sends the encrypted data in the tunnel. Okay, in the tunnel. So it was like a tunnel like this. Okay, if somebody enters into the tunnel, even if somebody enters into the tunnel, they will not know what is being transferred. Okay, why? Because the tunnel protocol, which uses encapsulation and encryption, the data is already encrypted, so they don't know. It hides the identity with another header, so it don't know what is happening inside there, and then it will connect to the server. Okay, once the request has been made, so this will send the information to the VPN server. So now this VPN server and the local network of this VPN server will authenticate. It should authenticate. Okay, once the authentication happened, okay, once the authentication is success, then what will happen? The information will be passed, otherwise not. So this is how the virtual private network has been used. The main important thing, the protocol which used here is tunneling protocol, okay, which has two important, which is using a very, very important thing, that is encapsulation for hiding the information of the user, and encryption. Okay, encryption. Understood, students? What is VPN? How VPN works? Have you understood? Tell me yes or no. Students, okay, so the next topic that we are going to study is website security consideration. Okay, third topic. Website security consideration. Okay. So what are the main important security consideration? Okay, first of all, we need to always update the software. Okay, the update software. whatever we use, we need to update the software. If there is any update comes, you update it. Okay, so it will provide you with some kind of it will avoid some kind of loss of information, or in order to prevent that accessing from the particular application. Now second one is we have beware of SQL injection. Okay, SQL injection. So what do you mean by SQL injection? Suppose if I am this is a web page. Okay, there is a web page. Okay, of it is asking you username and password. Okay, username and password in the web page. Okay, so you have a username and password in this asked in this web page. Now if you can see here, how we can access the web page here. Okay, let it be. So you will be getting the HTML pages, no? So once you just give me a second. Okay, so here what is happening in the SQL injection, when there is any website has been created, for example username or password, or any e-shopping website. Okay, any e-shopping website. So some attacker, what they can do is they can attack this web page and they can edit the content. They can edit the price of the contents, or they can edit the stock is not available. Okay, they can what they can do is they can make you loss in your business. Okay, so if, for example, if we consider this web page, they can steal the username and password, they can steal the credit card details or debit card details of a particular user, because whenever there is an e-shopping or any shopping website, what we'll do, we'll just enter into the website and we'll pay, do a payment once we purchase. So our debit card details or the credit card details might be stored in the network, okay, stored in the cookies. So the attacker can include some various SQL injection, SQL commands in order to hack the database. Okay, and he can change the content of the particular page. Okay, so that is possible. Okay, that can so people can might lose their business. Okay, so be aware of SQL injection to give a more protection to your particular website. So next one is the error message. Okay, error message. So most probably the website will be of showing if there is any error. So in the last Python class, you people have created a pages, right, web pages. So at that time when you log into the page, that it will be showing you if somebody entered wrongly, they will be producing, you will be like coded like it will be producing an error message. Okay, providing you error message. So here what will happen, error message in the sense, it is not like that error message. Error message in the sense, they will be creating a web page. Suppose this is a web page. Okay, This is the login page. Okay, so they when once you log in, no, once you log in, so after that, what will happen in the back end? It should go and open the another web page, right? It should open the another web page. Once you log in, you should get the information about the particular application, right? But what the attacker will do, they will be creating a error message that whatever you entered is wrong. Okay, so they will ask you to enter again. So what you people do? So you people will not take it very important, and you people will enter the detail. So at that time, whatever you enter, no, it will stored in the attacker's database. Okay, attacker's database. So he collected your information and he can do anything he wants. Okay. Now fourth one is the data validation. Data validation. So what do you mean by data validation? Okay. So what do you mean by data validation? So everything when you consider, no, the data, whatever you write, whatever you write in the web page, okay, the data should be valid. Okay, the data validation in the sense, you should update it new. You should be aware that whatever you have inserted on the web page properly, and every time you need to update what you have did already. Okay, so the data validation is also very, very important thing to consider web security. Okay, now the Now the fifth one we have is password. Okay, so here password in the sense in the web service, in the web page, normally if you want to log in any page, if there is any login page, okay, sign up or login page, so you will be using characters, right? So you will be using characters. The characters, not only characters you need to use, so nowadays it was like from past 2 to 3 years, they will be asking us to provide number, then characters and symbol. So now this will make the password strong or strengthier. Okay, so password needs to be protected. Okay, so when you log in, or when you provide, when you ask the client to insert a password, you need to, in order to provide you better security, you need to ask the web page, ask the password as to insert number, character and symbol combinations. Okay. Then the another thing, that is cross-site scripting. Cross-site scripting is nothing but so it allows the attacker to inject the client-side script into a web page. Okay, so the client-side information, the client-side scripts, okay, so that is the attacker can modify the code and he can inject the client side scripts also inside the web page. Okay, so therefore while creating if you are creating a particular form, it is you should make sure that the data is being submitted or it is there available. Okay, it is properly submitted or not, otherwise the attacker in the middle, he can able to cross site the particular website. That is possible. Okay, now the seventh one that we have is uploading files. So when you upload file, for example, if you are uploading a code, okay, into the particular, for example, if there is a Stack Overflow website there, likewise, MATLAB Overflow is there, okay. So here there are different websites that is available in order to provide you some kind of information about the coding. So that time when you upload the code, no, the attacker can able to attack if your website is not secure at all. Okay, so they can, when you upload the file or if you are uploading any script files on the particular website, so what will happen, it will also automatically run on the particular, on your web page, so that it will creating so many problems on the particular website. Okay, so see, these are the some kind of website security consideration you need to consider. Okay, and what are the functions that is providing when you apply website security? What is the functions it is providing? First of all, it is providing you integrity. Okay, when you say make in, you need to consider all these points in the mind, okay, to create, to provide security for the website. And once you created the, once you keep all this in your mind and you made the website secure, then it should follow the functions. It should provide the function called integrity, authentication, then confidentiality, then reliability. Okay, it should make sure of the integrity, there is no any content change. It should make sure that the request or a response is coming from the right entity. It should provide you confidentiality, whatever you send, it should reach the server, okay, properly. Then it should be a reliable one. Okay, so all these functions, when you consider a web security, so it should has the features of integrity, authentication, confidentiality, and reliability. Okay, understood, students? Understood? What are the web security consideration and how we can make the, because already we have discussed about the integrity, authentication, and the confidentiality. I don't want to elaborate it again and again. So I hope you understood today's topic, that VPN, HTTPS, and website security consideration, right? So have you understood, students? Tell me yes or no, students. Okay, very good. So I'll stop here. Okay, if you have any doubt, you can ask me. Otherwise, I